What are Ignite Talks? Last year, Michael Istria, I don't know if Michael is here, but Michael Istria, who always has good ideas, like the speaker pitches at the beginning of the afternoon. Michael and Benjamin also, you had this idea. They suggested to have this session to close the first day. So that's very short talks. Actually, we receive a lot of talks proposal, and we only have 40 slots for talks. So the idea is to give a chance to other talks to be shortened and much more to the point and presented in 5 minutes. So first one is Contributing to Eclipse. Yes, You Can, by Olivier Prouveau. So let's go, Olivier.
Okay.
Go.
Ah, yes.
Yes, take the microphone, yeah. That's better.
Okay, thank you. Try it, yes, okay. So, my name is Olivier Prouveau, and. Okay. Tu veux jouer avec là-bas? Ah, ok.
Vas-y.
Ah, mais je vois pas ce que je dis.
Go on stage. Ah, ok, sorry. So,
okay, no, it's pas grave.
Come back here.
Okay, it's pas grave. It's a talk about contribution. Contribution is usually you think it's only code, but actually you can contribute also with. You can open bugs, you can ask questions in forums. You can write some stuff in wiki. You can you must change the slide, please. Okay. You can write comments. You can make a lot of things. Even if you are not a developer, you can contribute easily. So this presentation will be provided as PDF. So you will get all the links after, because I have only 20 seconds per slide. So you can change now. Okay. So I will focus today on the code contribution. Maybe that could be something that you think it's difficult to contribute for the code, but actually now there are a lot of very powerful tools that helps you to contribute, and namely there is Git and Gerrit, and this is not very difficult tooling. Of course you have to learn it, but it's not so difficult to use. So there are a kind of process to start your contribution, and for instance you have to sign a CLE, but it's just some clicks on the website of Eclipse, and if you propose some contributions you can then maybe be proposed as a committer, and then you can review directly your contribution without waiting for a reviewer. Okay. So of course, before contributing, you must be safe with Git. So there are some resources for that. There is a book in French that's interesting. In French, you have the Git SCM book. And there's also a good article about how to merge and rebase code that can be interesting for you. And there is a new book that has been provided on Amazon this week. It's a Lars Vogel book. This book, you can buy it for only $6. That's not very expensive, but everything is explained. And it explains Git and Gerrit and so on. Okay. So where do you start for contributing? You must download the code of your project you want to contribute to. So for instance, you can get the e4tools project. Just with this command, you get the code. So if you go on giteclipse.org, you get the project. And at the end of the, you can click on the plus. Yes. And if you, you have a list, and at the end of the page, you have URLs to Git clone. So that's very easy to get. Then when the code is cloned on your computer, you just have to import the project in your Eclipse, and you just put them in the workspace and you can start to work on it. You can launch a new Eclipse with the code that you have modified. And of course you will create a specific launch configuration to use only the project in your workspace. So that's the first step. You can easily change a project like this. Just a remark about the Git organization. In the project, you have in the working directory, you have, you see at the bottom, there is build bundles and features. So the plugins of Eclipse, the Eclipse plugins are stored in the bundles directory. So if you have to change something, you get the project in bundles, then you just modify it and you test it after. Then if you change something, you will have to push it on the Git repository of Eclipse, but before the Git repository, there is a Gerrit step. Gerrit is a project that can that get the Git commit, and it creates a review that must be checked by committers. So if you are not a committer, you will have to wait that committer review your code. And this review is, there is a notation with -2 to +2. And if it's +2, the code is merged in the master branch of the project. And if it's not good, you will get a comment. You have to change, and then you must push it again. So this is a Gerrit UI, where you have a lot of different reviews. So you can, if you click on one, you will get a specific UI. And in this UI, you will get, okay, you can change that. Okay. If you want to push to Git, you have to configure a specific push URL in the Git configuration. So this is everything is explained in the Git on the Gerrit and Git documentation. But this is two different URLs. So when you have a review, the review is just something where there are some comments. And if you open the review, you have you can go to the next slide, please. Okay. And you have some information who made the code and so on. And there is a number, which is the number of the review. So you can find it in the URL, but you have also it in the main URL of the page or in this Git fetch Git. There is a number here. This is 28,552, for instance. And this number is used when you want to test a review. You can get the code of the contributor, and you can fetch it from Gerrit. So there is a specific item command menu to do that. So it's a fetch from Gerrit, and you have a specific UI in Eclipse where you just enter the number, and automatically when you do a control space, it will propose all the patches, the available patches of this commit, because maybe the guy who contributes maybe made some mistakes, and you have to get the latest commit. So then, when the guy wants to contribute again and fix another patch, he has to commit again, but he must not do a new commit. He must amend the commit. So for that, there is a specific UI also in the Git staging view, where you have this is the view we use when you commit some code in Git. And in this view, you have two buttons on the upper left part to add the change ID and the sign off. And then you must set a comment. The comment must contain the bug ID. So you must have a bug opened for the contribution. That's important. Then it's possible, there was a fault, okay. Then it's possible also to build the project on your computer directly without having the Eclipse builder process. You can do it, you go in the Git repositories and you just launch MVN clean install, and it will clean everything and it will build all your project, and you will get the repository that you can use and you can test it if you want to test it before definitively delivered your code. That can be interesting if you create new plugins. If you just change a plugin that exists already, you don't have to clean and to do it again to build the project. So I don't know how many times.
That's done.
That's up. Okay. So you don't have to be afraid. If you want to contribute to Eclipse, it's very easy. And now there are a lot of very interesting documentation. That's a funny process because it's very easy actually to do. And everybody can do it. Even if you are not a committer, you can contribute and you can fix patches. So that's very easy. So, okay, I think I'm okay.
Okay.
I forgot something, but okay.
Thank you. That's you.
Next one is Forget your Excel worksheets. The model-based safety analysis is coming by Jonathan Dumont from All4Tech. So let's go, Jonathan.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. So I'm here to present to you in 5 minutes what is a model-based safety analysis and how it can help you if you perform safety analysis with your model. And so just to sum up, All4Tech is a little company, independent, present all over the world, and Eclipse member since this year. We are recognized for our expertise and our relation with a different customer in different fields, and we have also different kind of expertise in the system, in the safety, and also in the process engineering. So we have three main solutions. The first one is made for the model-based testing, which is Matello, Markov Test Logic. The second one is Safety Architect that I will present to you, which is made for the model-based safety analysis. And the last one is an offer made for the support of the CEA tool Papyrus, which is quite new. And so the model-based safety analysis, what it is, the main goal is to avoid your system to fail or to know how it will react if it fails. The experts are now working with Excel worksheet and just their expertise. They have two main techniques to prove that the system is okay. It's the first one is the fault tree analysis, and the second one is the FMEA, just a table which sum up all the critical failures that can happen. If you make model-based safety analysis, you can make it in parallel to the software design. So the first step is to analyze all the system field events, then the subsystem, and finally you can analyze all the risk on each block of your model. It's like an approach in black box, white box. Our methodology is based on this approach. So the first step, if you have a model, is to analyze each leaf block and ensure that if it fails, you can know which inputs are the cause of this failure. And then, after this manual step, you can have a global propagation, which is automatic, and which will propagate the error in the whole model. We have made a tool for this to help all the safety engineers, which began in 2011, and which is now in a new version based on Papyrus, and which have been built also with the CEA in our common laboratory, Call4S. Just to sum up what the tool's done, you can import your models and your requirements, and after you have made the different steps that I have presented, you can generate the report necessary to prove that your system respects all the analysis requirements that you have defined before. This is important to have a tool to decrease the risk of manual error and also to gain some money, of course. Our cycle of analysis is really important and is really made in parallel to the system design, as you can iterate on each version of your system and ensure that each version is better and better. Just a quick feedback on the development of these tools. We have chosen Eclipse RCP to have a common backbone with our different tools, which, for example, Matello, and for also different reasons. The community is really active, and you have an open source strategy which is really of high quality. This is important for us because we have to be we have to prove that our tools will really rely on something which is important and works. The second step is we have to choose between DSL and UML. If you speak to different customers, some are using really their approach, so they use DSL, and some rely on standard and use UML. We want to make something which can answer to the different needs, and that's why we have chosen Papyrus. So the different technical components that we use are Papyrus for the main blocks, but also EMF, EMF DiffMerge to compare the model, ETL, BERT for the report, and also Nebula for the table, which are quite complicated. And now the benefits of Eclipse will also is also a thing important for us, and we want to propose our tools in open source in this community, because it will bring us a real visibility to our customer, and also to be available for the different industrial. Yeah. So it's really a main strategy for our company to become a member of Polarsys now that we are a member of Eclipse, to integrate Papyrus and to work with Papyrus. That's why we also use our expertise to propose support for this. And the next step will be to have our tools in the Polarsys community. Thank you.
Thank you. C'est bien.
Good evening. I'm going to talk about the new dashboard that we are deploying for Eclipse. It's a dashboard with information about how Eclipse is being built, how Eclipse is being developed. So this is the main panel of the dashboard. You have the real thing in the internet right now, so you can go there, have a look at it. By the way, if you had a look at it during the past week or something, have a look again, because we did some improvements for this conference. This is just a summary of all the activity, and next slide, please. This is the software which we are using to produce it. It's all of it is free software, so you can replicate everything if you want. We have tools for retrieving information from repositories, from Git, from Baxilla, from Gerrit repositories, from mailing lists, and so on. Then we put all the information into a database, and with that information, we produce some JSON files that are visualized by some JavaScript code, which is what you see. That's basically Visual Grimoire and Metrics Grimoire when we come to code. Again, this is the main panel of the dashboard. On the top, you have information from coming from Git, number of commits over time, number of authors over time for all the history of Eclipse. Then you have tickets, then you have discussion in mailing list, I mean development mailing list, and in the bottom, you have information from code review from Gary. You have the main parameters are actors and actions. I mean, for instance, number of tickets and number of ticket openers. These are the main parameters of the project for all the history. So for instance, you have like 2,500 developers over all the history of Eclipse, or you have like, 50,000 people participating in tickets. This is an example of some of the charts. By the way, you can click on them and enlarge them and select periods of time and things like that if you want. In the bottom of the chart, you have trends, like what's happening in the project during the last year, during the last month, during the last week, so that you can get an idea of what's happening on periods. This is a view of commits. And again, you have the commits and the author's history. And on the right, you have things like who is committing the most for a certain period of time. Or this is just commits. Of course, this is not a lot of information about who is contributing the most. But at least you have some information about who is, let's say, most popular by number of commits. And the trends, again, are also interesting. You can see whether basically you are having more activity, less activity in the large. This is the same thing in this case by repository. So you can drill down to its repository and you can see basically which repositories are more active for the whole history of Eclipse. And then you can also go to each of them. So for instance, this is org eclipsebert.git. And you can look at the evolution over time for that specific repository, again, for number of committers, number of commits, and things like that. We have similar things for tickets. Again, you have the trends, and you have the numbers on the right, and you have the main participants, and by company. So you can also drill down and see which companies are contributing, and you can select one company and see the contribution of that company over time. Again, in things like number of commits or number of authors. Just a note here, when number of commits is metric with some issues, you all know, authors is pretty interesting because that means at least one person of that company was involved at some point in Eclipse. So that's the kind of information you have in there. This is an example of what you get when you drill down to what's doing a company in the project. So this is one company and you can see the different patterns of contribution to the project over time. different moments, so depending on many issues that companies contributed more or less, with more people or less people, more focused on maybe committing, maybe closing tickets, whichever. You can also drill down to persons, and you can see the history of any developer, and you can have an idea of, again, in which repositories is working more or less, which kind of activity is doing, and the pattern of a time. And just to finish, there are some helps to navigation. You can go to any of the web, of the Eclipse projects. They are grouped by categories, and you can drill down to any of them and select information for a specific project. And on the left, you also have that menu, the lines, where you can select all the data sources, I mean the repositories, for any of these projects. And this is all. Please go check the real thing. Remember, this is still work in progress. Any feedback is appreciated. There is a ticket about this in Baxilla, and of course, you can also send email. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rodis. So next one is about Neo4EMF.
C'est toi qui passe les slides. J'ai 20 secondes pour prendre aussi.
Ouais, à peu près.
On s'est prévu. Hein.
OK. Let's go.
OK, so my name is Hugo Brunolière. I'm a member of the AtlonMod research team, a team that is dealing with model-driven engineering stuffs, and more particularly, we are building quite a lot of prototypes around the Eclipse modeling framework. And today I'm going to introduce you Neo4EMF. So basically the idea of Neo4EMF is to deal with big models. So of course now big data is everywhere, and it's very true in the context of Eclipse modeling framework, in which we are dealing with models, with data, so with big models at the end. So of course there are already solutions existing to deal with scalability in this context. CDO, EMF store are well-known solutions, but in a different context, we may want to find other alternatives to do this. So here the idea, the rationale behind this is to be able to find the right balance between time consumption and memory consumption. So depending on the cases, we may want the time or the memory to be more or less important. And that's why we studied the use of Neo4j, that is a well-known graph database that has very important performances. So that's what is Neo4EMF basically. This is the wedding between EMF and Neo4j. Basically the idea is to be able in EMF models to use data coming from Neo4j graph databases. So that's the main purpose of the approach. So what we want to provide in there, so first Java code generation, not typical EMF Java code generation, but Java code generation that is actually targeting data coming from Neo4EMF. Of course, this code generation implements some more facilities, for instance, on-demand unloading facilities that allows to access specific parts of the model more with. It's already gone, okay. And of course, improved querying. Okay, you can go. So how this works concretely. So at a very high level, we have Neo4EMF resources. We have a log that plays the role of the interface between the users and between these Neo4EMF resources. And thanks to this, we are able to provide to the user some load on demand facilities and some facilities to access to the data stored in the model. So now concretely, if you look a bit to the interface, how it looks like. So it looks like basically as you start with a normal EMF project, so you create your EMF project, but instead of selecting the typical eCore model importer, you have a specific one that is for Neo4EMF. Then you select this. So before entering your typical EMF project data, first the system is checking whether you have already installed in your system all the Neo4j runtime that is needed for the tool to be able to run. So if not, a wizard will be automatically launched and you will be guided through the installation of this. And once done, you can continue with the process. So then, if you look to the gen model that is produced, so apart from the typical thing that you find in an EMF gen model, you will find specific references to some Neo4EMF things, such as, for instance, new templates for the generated code, of course, new types of objects, Neo4EMF objects, or new references to Neo4j specific libraries. So all this is automatically set. Then the generated code itself, so it looks quite familiar for those that who are familiar with EMF, of course, but you can see some specificities. As I said before, you have this load on demand thing that is already provided in the generated code. You have also references to some specific Neo4EMF list or containers that are used to speed up the process. If you want to handle the resource, then so you can use, of course, all the basic EMF APIs. But in addition to this, we provide some more facilities. Notably, we can mention some methods that allow to do some loading of data in specific part of the system. And also, the idea behind this, of course, is not to use this tool as a standalone tool. The idea is to try to integrate these in other Eclipse modeling tools relying on EMF. So we have done some first experiments with the Eclipse Modisco project, and we have implemented a specific model discoverer from Java project that is actually using this Neo4EMF technology. Just before finishing, a few evaluation that we have done so far. So here you can see some evaluation on a model which is about 400 megabytes approximately. And here the idea was to check what happens when we do load, full navigation, and save. So you can see that Neo4EMF is a bit more time consuming than other solution, notably CDO. But on the contrary, you gain a lot in memory. More interestingly, when we reach the limitation of XMI, notably, so here we have a 1 gigabyte model, which is already quite big. And we have more specific queries that only targets parts of the model. Here we can see that, again, it's a bit more time consuming, but on the opposite, you gain a lot also in memory. So as I said before, this is the trade-off. So that's all for me. So of course, you can check us out. The tool is there. You have some documentation. You can download the tool. You can try it out. Don't hesitate to contact us if you have any questions related to the tool itself or to the approach. And of course, you can fork the code from GitHub. That's all. Thanks.
Thank you.
So next one is model-based requirements engineering on the web built on Eclipse Wrap and GMF.
Yeah, hello. So my name is Tom Ritter from Fraunhofer Focus, Berlin, Germany. I'm going to present you something about our requirements engineering tool, particular built on the web and targeted towards small and medium-sized enterprises, in particular in the mechatronics domain. So they have particular requirements, challenges they are facing, so they need to work interdisciplinary. They have short development life cycles. They have limited resources, and they are competing on a global market. What they can do currently and use currently for tools are either very lightweight, like Excel or Word or something like this, or very heavyweight, like DAWs, for example. And our goal was really to combine the benefit of both of these worlds and to link this also with a specific methodology which fits for these SMEs and which fits for the mechatronics domain. The methodology starts with some concept spaces so that you describe actually the requirements in an abstract way, concrete way, and in a complete way. You do this by describing the system under development, and you can do it with this kind of editor. After this, you go to the solutions specification where you can define different solutions and evaluate these solutions in different versions of the solutions with the requirements so that you can see how good a specific solution fulfills specific requirements. In the methodology, we have also foreseen, and it's also realized in the tool, the inclusion of specific analysis methods like the FMEA and the QFD, which helps the mechatronics guys really to make some analysis of their systems. From a technical point of view, we have done this on a web based on RAP and Dart. But at the same time, there was a requirement to put it also into a desktop version. So we need to present both of these things. And we have a couple of user interfaces, tree view-like and spreadsheet-like, but also some modeling things. We placed our tool upon our Modibus framework, which gives us some advantages in terms of user management, user collaboration, persistence, and stuff like this. When we decided to make this tool based on a web, we had two options, either to port an existing tool to the web or do something very new, or then finally we come to the way and porting GMF and generate the typical editors for GMF. was quite a substantial amount of work to do this. So it took us a long time, and we finished with almost 90% of the work. Some features are still missing, but in general it worked now. For 1.5 of RAP, 2.x is a different story. When it comes to the user interface, you can see we have a very simple tree view and spreadsheet like user interface, which is very good even for the non-modeling experts. You can track changes and stuff like this, so it's quite common interface. But on the other side, we have also graphical things, graphical dialogues coming from SysML, UML, so that they can really structure the systems and the requirements with behavior diagrams and structure diagrams. So it's quite interesting to describe the system in this or describe the requirements of the systems in this way. Additionally, we have also an evaluation view, which allows the user to evaluate the different versions of their proposed solution with the help of some merit functions. They have all the time feedback how good they actually meet the requirements. Yes, and finally, you can see also that we benefit from this Modibus framework with some interactive modes, so they can really interactively work on the same model, on the same requirements model, make some locking and unlocking and stuff like this. And this works also for the graphical for the modeling, of course. Now you have 20 seconds to look for this web URLs or to contact me. I will be around at the reception and have probably some nice chat about this. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
So next one is send push notifications to your connected objects with Vertex.
Okay, welcome everybody. I'm Sébastien Blanc. I'm working for Red Hat JBoss, and I have 5 minutes to tell you how cool it will be to send push notification to connected objects. And starts now.
Oh yeah, it's already started.
Okay. You all know about push notifications, these little messages that you receive on your phone when someone gives you a life in Candy Crush, or when your bank account is empty, or when Holland scores a goal. It's really short messages, and you can combine that with other factors, like location or other sensors. Who can receive them? Well, obviously, smartphones can receive push notification, but also your tablets. Also, e-readers, things of the Amazon Kindle Fire, it can receive push notification, and web apps. Think of Facebook or Twitter. When you receive a notification, it just pops on your web browser. But what about our friends, the connected objects? Don't they deserve also to receive push notifications? Imagine this connected fridge and the local supermarket sending a notification that he has fresh products, or your car sending a push notification, hey, be careful, there's a cop at the other side of the street. But what for protocol do we want to use to that? Well, it will be good if we use an existing protocol that already manages push notification. But if you look at the existing one from Google, from Apple, from Amazon, from Windows, it's all closed source and not extendable. It's private. You cannot use that. You cannot deploy that on your connected objects. Mozilla came recently with its own protocol, the simple push protocol. It's used for his mobile Firefox OS devices. It's open. It's open source, totally open. It's light, privacy friendly. It will probably become the future spec for the web push as well. So how does it work in 20 seconds? Your client registers with a simple push server, and then it just creates a WebSocket connection, and then your business application just sends a post request to your SPS server, and it just pings through WebSocket your client, so it's really lightweight. A protocol without implementation is totally useless, so of course Mozilla has its own implementation, but we decide to make also an implementation of the simple push server, the Aerogear team, using a Vertex. And why Vertex? Because Vertex, first, it's an Eclipse Foundation project. That's why my talk was chosen. It's scalable, so it can manage millions of connections. It's really good in handling WebSocket connection, and that is exactly what we need for Simple Push. And it is supported by a lot of cloud solution and by OpenShift, for instance. The client, because you have to deploy something on your client, your connected object. So there's a Simple Push Java client, which implements protocol. It's a simple jar, and it even runs on the embedded GDK. So if we look at the code example, it's quite simple. You just make an instance of the Simple Push client, you connect to the Simple Push server, and then you just have to implement the unregistered once you are registered, and on the on message. And basically, when you receive a push notification, this method will be called. So it's really easy to implement. Proof of concept. All what I'm telling you is not just theory or a nice idea. I've been playing with that. I'm able to send push notification to my Lego robot. It's very funny. And I'm also able to send push notification to my Raspberry Pi. But even, yeah, you can go. Even nicer is when you go unified. Imagine your backend logic don't want to know if your device is a connected object, a web browser, or whatever. It just want to notify the client. You can use the unified push server. You just send one message, and the unified push server from IvoGear will just take care of sending the same message to your mobile device, to your robot, really exciting robot, or to your Raspberry Pi. So the idea is, could that be a new standard for notifying connected objects? Because it's something that will be really cool. It's in the really early ages. I started with that 1 month ago. We start to discuss with Mozilla, and they show some interest. So last slide is, we need you. If you like this project, just come to talk to me tonight or tomorrow. What will be cool will be other client implementation in Python, for instance. Imagine use cases, because I'm sending push notification to my robot that launch a ball. It's funny, but yeah, we could imagine some serious use cases. And if you like the concept, just talk about this around you and evangelize the concept. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, I start right away because I don't have much time. Before I was telling you that if you don't know what is infinitely scalable, you can come and listen. So let's start.
Let's go.
What is infinitely scalable is very easy. It's something which basically the cost of a system which is infinitely scalable increases linearly with the number of users. Most of the systems today are not infinitely scalable, so basically it works well with a limited number of users, but when you increase the size, then you realize you have a lot of problems. Time determinism, this is when the system has a bounded response time. The difficulty of what we are going to talk today is to have a system with bounded response time and being also infinitely scalable. Alors, why scalability is important? It's basically, as we go, we know that we have more and more computing power through parallelism. Most we are using also more and more distributed systems to get processing power. There are a lot of limits to, this is an important slide, can you just make sure? The limit to scalability and responsiveness are basically a resource bottleneck, locks, algorithm. This is the biggest problem with it's basically you are using an algorithm which doesn't grow linearly. So when you increase the input size, you have to wait. And you have also non-scalable architecture, knowing that you have two kinds of scalability, which is one is horizontal scaling, and the other one is vertical scaling. I don't have time to read, you can read. On the last one, which is interesting, is the use of non-scalable, non-time deterministic Java library, such as the standard Java library. So we have a project which is called Javolution. It's an open source project. It's with a library which is an OSGI bundle. And there is a lot of idea behind the Javolution project, which we are going to cover very quickly. You see a list here, which we are going to, I'm not going to go in detail because we are going to see them there. First, you have real-time annotation, which basically document the behavior of your methods based according to the input side. So you have real-time multi-parallelized, which tell you if you have hidden some kind of locking mechanism, which is going to do a bottleneck. So you have, for example, here a table where the function index of object in a list is as a limit which is linear. So you know that basically when you do an index of, you will have to wait based on the size of the list. So Javolution, as I say, is an open source project with a lot of different classes. And we have all the classical collection classes with a specific view. What is interesting here is you have, for example, the two views, which is, one is atomic and the other one is shared. The difference being that the atomic is mutex free. So you don't have any locks, you can read, you don't have to wait. If you have concurrent thread reading, there is no lock or waiting. And share, which is a reader-writer lock, which allows multiple read on a single write. But you have also other views. The idea behind that is you don't have many classes, but you can compound and make the class you want using the view. So view are very similar for people who are who know a little bit about Java 8 to Java 8 stream. So basically, you have a view which can be, in this case, atomic. And on this, you are going to be able to do operation. The difference with the stream is you can do operation on the view, and it's going to impact the actual target collection. For the vertical scaling, the solution that we advocate in Javolution is to use a compute context. A compute context is something where basically you do some calculation asynchronously. It's going to use, if you have GPU or multicore, it's going to do this on your GPU using OpenCL binding, Java binding behind it. What is interesting also is you don't have any heap allocation because the memory of your object is on the device. Like they say, the device, the memory of your object is on the device and it stays on the device unless you need to see the result. So basically, you can chain calculation, they are all done on the device until you want to output the result. It's all done on the device because you want to minimize the transfer between the device memory and the current memory. Oh, go back. Yeah, no, it's fine. It's fine. This one, go back. You go next. So we have also a specific collection, which implementation of the standard collection, which limit, reduce the worst case execution time. You know that the standard libraries, you have array list and you have resize. As each time you have you add an element, it can trigger a resize. With the Java library, you never have a resize, you have incremental resize, so which means that the response time is always bounded on none. And you can see the difference in the performance with the standard library. And also, and this is another important aspect, is for when you do distribution, for horizontal scaling, you need to serialize, and we have XML serializer, which have very close to the stacks, go back please, to the stacks XML reader and writer, except that using in the interface a string, we use character sequence, which is an interface, which allow us to go up to 10 times faster than the standard stack. Finally, and this is the last idea, it's because we have a lot of devices which are we don't have support for Java. We have a mirror of the library in C++, which is a Java-like library. So basically, if you look at the code, you will see it's very similar to what you have on the Java side. Using this, we ported OSGI, for example. OSGI JUnit has been ported in less than 1 week. So in C++, so now we have OSGI on C++. Next slide. Last word. So this is an open source project. I hope this presentation will suscitate some interest to you to go on to see more. If you want to look at this project and participate, you are welcome. And the website is javolution.org.
Thank you.